Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Smarter Collaboration, a new approach to breaking down barriers and transforming work by Heidi K. Gardner and Ivan A. Matviak. Narrated by Melissa Redmond. Publisher's note: this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures and tables referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Preface: the origins of smarter collaboration. This book is an example of smarter collaboration in action. A half decade ago, Harvard Business Review Press published my first book, Smart Collaboration. As my thinking evolved and my work with organizations expanded, I came to see both the tremendous untapped opportunities related to smart collaboration and the limits of my own experiences and knowledge base in pursuing those opportunities. So as I explained later, I took my own advice and joined forces with a smart collaborator, Ivan Matviak. You'll hear from him in a moment. Smart collaboration drew on my somewhat eclectic experiences over the previous two decades or so in both the academic and professional worlds. I had earned graduate degrees in organizational behavior from the London School of Economics and London Business School, and I had spent 5 years working as a consultant for McKinsey & Company. The result, as I can now see in retrospect, was a perspective that was both data-driven and strategy-oriented. I subsequently broadened that perspective through a decade of teaching and research at Harvard's business and law schools, both institutions with a keen interest in the intersection of theory and practice. My research at that time focused on the economics and working practices of large, complex professional service firms, or PSFs, law firms, accountancies, consulting and engineering firms, and so on. Several of those PSFs granted me extraordinary and unprecedented access to their financials, for which I will always be grateful. I learned a lot from them and with them. Smart collaboration focused on a challenge confronting those leading PSFs. Their clients increasingly needed them to tackle the kinds of VUCA problems, volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous, that only multidisciplinary cross-functional teams of experts could address effectively. But PSFs had historically organized themselves into narrowly defined and highly specialized practice areas, an organizational structure that tended to make intra-firm collaboration messy, risky, and expensive. My decade of research revealed an important insight. Firms that figured out how to collaborate across silos, building teams of experts with complementary expertise, gained a major competitive edge over those that did not. That edge took many forms. For example, collaborative firms tended to move into higher margin work, gain more satisfied clients, improve their lateral hiring, decrease enterprise risk, innovate faster, engage their employees more fully, and strengthen their bottom line results. Highly collaborative individuals benefited as well. Practitioners who thrived successfully built networks across boundaries within the firm and then invoked those networks to deliver higher value work to clients. And this turned out to be a virtuous circle. Solving one complex client problem collaboratively in a realm like cybersecurity or mergers and acquisitions or cross-border trade earned those collaboration-oriented practitioners the opportunity to get involved in bigger and more lucrative challenges down the road. The individuals, their firm, and ultimately their clients all benefited. I came to call this virtuous circle smart collaboration, which became the focus and title of that first book. Smart collaboration caused a bit of a stir. It became a Washington Post bestseller and was recognized among PSFs as the go-to resource on collaboration. I continued to advocate for the book's main prescriptions, advising PSF leaders and speaking to tens of thousands of people at hundreds of events around the world. Through that advocacy, I noticed a surprising phenomenon. Whereas my initial clients and audiences tended to consist mainly of representatives from PSFs, over time, more and more private sector and not-for-profit leaders reached out to me. My research and client work increasingly focused on corporations, government agencies, and non-governmental organizations. The marketplace, I realized, was confirming that smart collaboration had implications far beyond the world of PSFs. Drawing on this broader framework, I wrote multiple collaboration-oriented Harvard Business Review articles, including The Overcommitted Organization, 2017 with Mark Mortensen, that laid the foundations for Chapter 12 in this book, and Collaboration in a Crisis, 2020. My co-author on that second article was Ivan A. Matviak. I'll turn it over to him now. Over the years, Heidi and I talked about how the concepts of smart collaboration were evolving. During the COVID-19 pandemic, we worked together on a couple of articles published in Harvard Business Review. Those articles were well received, and the two of us, who happened to be married, decided to collaborate on a new book. While she was writing the first book, I had served as a real-world sounding board, and early on, we discussed applying the ideas beyond PSFs to various industries I've worked in. My own experiences working around the world and across several industries, for example, as president of a software company, in executive roles at a major global bank, as a consultant at Bain & Company, and as an advisor to private equity firms, added new dimensions to the research and ideas in this book. From that point on, we've been working as a pair of smart collaborators, bringing different expertise, experiences, and perspectives to bear on a complex problem. The I narrative voice in smart collaboration turned into the we of smarter collaboration. In that spirit, we welcome you to the broader horizons of smarter collaboration. Heidi K. Gardner and Ivan Matviak. Introduction. Get smarter about collaboration. Right now, the stakes for effective collaboration could not be higher. A fly-on-the-wall visit to a Bay Area fintech company we'll call ModFin provides a typical business example. Oren Weiss runs a key division at ModFin, and he knows that his team and the larger company are in trouble. For the past few years, competitors have been faster to market with new products, and ModFin has lost several important clients. Meanwhile, the challenges faced by the entire fintech sector have been mounting steadily. For example, meeting ever greater demands for complex data and analytics, enhancing the user experience through personalized services, and complying with regulations. Weiss knows that only companies that address these challenges will survive. ModFin has hardly been coasting. Like many of its competitors, it took advantage of remote working to hire new developers and salespeople in Edinburgh, Boston, Austin, Mumbai, and Miami, all while growing in double digits. But Weiss is pretty sure it's not all rosy. To him, it feels like ModFin's culture, formerly a strong suit, is declining. His team members seem to have lost the sense of pride, ownership, and excitement they felt in the fintech's startup days. Weiss decides that broad-based collaboration on a big, meaningful project might help revive that sense of purpose. Toward that end, he pulls together a cross-functional, company-wide team to rethink their product roadmap. What new functionalities should they develop, and how can they get there faster? Using a combination of in-person meetings and remote teaming platforms, the group spends 2 days brainstorming ideas. While the sessions seem reasonably productive, several things give him pause. Most in-person attendees are members of Weiss's long-standing core team, who have worked together for years. Left to their own devices, they are likely to regroup on their own after the sessions to decide what's really going to happen. Meanwhile, the people participating through the company's video platform are mostly new to ModFin, aren't familiar with the other participants' roles, and struggle to contribute to the sessions. A product manager from another division says, "Okay, but I don't really see how my products fit in." Several of his senior engineers roll their eyes whenever one of the younger digital marketing managers puts an idea on the table. One of the new hotshot developers seems to be tuning out during much of the conversation. Over lunch, Weiss asks her what's going on. "Sorry," the developer replies, "but this is the 7th project I've been asked to work on this month. I'm tapped out." Overall, Weiss's instincts are on target. ModFin does indeed have problems, external and internal, and fixing those problems will require new kinds of input. And this is the same conclusion that many savvy business leaders today are reaching. Success going forward will absolutely demand multifaceted inputs, necessitating more and better collaboration both within their organizations and with outside partners. And by the way, this same challenge faces all kinds of complex organizations. Yes, for-profits need to find ways to get ahead of their business challenges, to serve their customers better, or to more consistently engage in more profitable work. At the same time, though, nonprofits also want to carry out their missions more effectively. So collaboration has become a hot topic. Across many sectors and industries, organizations are realizing that they have to get better at collaboration, and many are plunging in. But it's easy to get implementation wrong and fall into what might be called collaboration traps. For example, some leaders treat collaboration as a magic cure-all, as if all they need to do is form a team and their challenges will go away. Others consider collaboration an initiative that can be implemented and then left to fend for itself. Some organizations focus on collaboration as a goal in and of itself. In those cases, collaboration becomes an explicit organizational value. This sounds good, but in practice, it often means that people aren't shown how specific collaborative behaviors will help realize the company's strategic goals. Some managers wind up throwing teams at every problem, which commits valuable employees to too many different projects and thus stretches good people too thin. Some leaders instruct people to collaborate on X, Y, or Z without equipping them with the skills or technology to do it well. Some go the exact opposite route, showering people with teamworking technologies on the assumption that getting people wired up right will lead naturally to great outcomes. Some companies develop strong implementation plans but backtrack in the face of a crisis or retrench when they don't get the quick payback they are hoping for. Many leaders fail to realize how badly managed collaboration can undermine their already complicated diversity, equity, and inclusion initiatives. This is a sobering list of collaborative traps, myths, and missteps, and the danger is real. But what about the upside? What about smart collaboration? Done right, collaboration works, and it amply rewards those organizations that embrace it. In the half decade since the publication of Smart Collaboration, we have seen many organizations deeply transformed through their embrace of the concepts we laid out in that book. They have accelerated innovation, improved service, and enhanced employee engagement. In the process, they also generated higher revenues and profits, gained market share, and accelerated growth. Nonprofits have experienced similar gratifying results from effective collaboration, advancing their strategies in new and compelling ways. This past half decade has given us the opportunity to research how these diverse organizations have rolled out their collaboration initiatives and to assess their results. Based on solid implementations of collaboration in an ever broader range of sectors, we've continued to refine our understanding of its basic tenets. Organizations ranging from the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute to Bridgewater Associates to PwC to the U.S. Cyberspace Solarium Commission have worked with us, pushed our thinking, and helped us make real contributions to the field. Through this iterative process, our definition of smart collaboration has gotten broader and deeper. Now it's time to take these ideas to the next level. We need to consolidate learnings about best practices and provide a roadmap for execution. Looking forward, it's the right juncture to help new people, teams, and companies get into smarter collaboration and thereby reap the benefits of a uniquely powerful approach to organizing, deploying, and retaining some of their most important talent. That's what this book is about. The whys, whos, and hows of smarter collaboration. Smart collaboration focused primarily on the why. It stressed that the benefits of cross-functional collaboration are real and can be measured. Outcomes like revenues, profits, customer loyalty, diversity, and employee attraction, retention, and engagement. In other words, smart collaboration is far from a soft topic or a nice-to-have. Instead, it's at the very heart of how savvy organizations operate today. Over the past half decade, we've conducted more than 400 in-depth interviews with senior corporate leaders. Based in part on that input, we've launched collaboration pilot projects with some of the world's leading companies, applying the concepts of smarter collaboration to address real-world obstacles and drive successes. Building on these foundations, smarter collaboration continues to make the why case, now expanded to reflect our work in such diverse industries as financial services, healthcare, biotech and pharma, consumer products, automotive, technology, telecoms and media, energy, government, and higher education. But smarter collaboration goes much further, with a new emphasis on the who and how. For example, when it comes to who, we now recommend a focus on who thinks differently from me, as well as who knows something different from me. In the past half decade, diversity, equity, and inclusion issues have come to the fore in a wide range of organizational settings. Diversity means an appropriate mix of function-related talents that must contribute to solving the problem at hand, such as marketing, product, finance, and technology. But it also means a purposeful mix of educational, geographic, and economic backgrounds, as well as genders and ethnicities, especially if the problem extends beyond the purely technical. Reflecting another new dimension of who, we also explore third-party collaboration, which has become significantly more important since the publication of the previous book. Just as professionals must increasingly specialize in their domain to develop deep expertise, so too must organizations focus their talent and resources to differentiate themselves from the competition. This means they need to collaborate with experts outside their own boundaries. By design, this book asks and answers practical questions. What are the barriers to smart collaboration? How are they overcome? And those answers, again, come directly from the front lines. For example, we worked with one very large company for more than 3 years across 45 countries, starting from scratch and continuing through the co-development, testing, and rolling out of tailored solutions around the world. These real-world collaborators consistently pushed us to focus on implementation. Why, who, and how? Today, we continue to work with a growing list of complex institutions to refine these practical solutions. Collectively, these experiences help anchor our narrative in up-to-the-minute organizational realities. For example, how do corporations break down internal silos to generate innovative solutions to customers' most complex problems and thereby drive profitable growth? How do companies use technology, data, and analytics to facilitate, analyze, and continually improve collaboration, especially given the realities of hybrid working? How do organizations work across government, corporate, and non-governmental organization boundaries to address some of society's biggest challenges, like climate change? The rich examples in this book will show vividly how smart collaboration goes well beyond classic teaming. The fundamentals of smarter collaboration. Throughout this book, we'll use three lenses to explore smarter collaboration. The why. Hyper-intentional to tackle truly complex issues. Aimed at achieving breakthrough insights, innovation, and transformational change. Focused on a sense of purpose. The who. The right number of team members. Expanding beyond the boundaries of the usual suspects. Diverse in expertise, perspectives, and other aspects. The how. Inclusive. Not just having people on the team, but truly engaging them. Tech and tool base to facilitate communication, support hybrid working, analyze performance, and increase efficiency. Measured, both collaboration and the related outcomes. Developmental, creating real-time learning environments to increase collaborative capabilities. The roadmap. Smarter collaboration consists of four parts. Part 1, the case for smarter collaboration, lays out the competitive arguments in favor of collaboration. Chapter 1, the business case, and moves on to the talent case, that is, why embracing smart collaboration helps companies recruit, engage, and retain great people. Chapter 2, the talent case. Part 2, assessing your collaborative starting point, presents a set of methodologies for judging the strength of your collaborative foundations. The organizational diagnostic, Chapter 3, enterprise-wide diagnostic, presents a powerful approach to assess your company's collaborative opportunities and prioritize actions to deliver a return on your efforts. We have also developed a toolkit, available through Harvard Business Review Press, with practical templates, instructions, and approaches for applying the concepts in your organization. Chapter 4, Individual and Team Diagnostic, presents a new way of looking at the behaviors underlying smarter collaboration so that every person can understand how to use their natural way of operating as a strength to contribute to collaborative teams. Part 3, How-tos and Use Cases for Smarter Collaboration, provides a holistic approach to the who and how of collaboration. Starting with building a collaborative talent pool, Chapter 5, Collaborating to Succeed at Hiring and M&A, shows how collaboration helps solve a major problem that has stumped organizations for decades, making sure that the people you bring aboard, whether through recruitment or acquisition, actually stick around, become profitable, and thrive in the long run. No matter how you grow your employee base, how do you motivate people to engage in collaboration rather than individualistic endeavors? Chapter 6, Paying People to Collaborate, presents a comprehensive three-part system that combines aspirational goals and performance metrics, discussions aimed at performance improvement and development, and a revamped annual compensation review. Even the most motivated performers need strategically aligned structures to help them take full advantage of their collaborative efforts. In Chapter 7, Collaborating Through a Sector Lens, we explore how a company can adopt sector-oriented structures that encourage people across the organization to integrate their unique views and generate more holistic solutions that are tailored to a customer's industry. Since all of those transformative efforts require significant ongoing vigilance and leadership, Chapter 8, Leading and Sustaining a Collaborative Transformation, tackles the challenge of supporting collaborative efforts over time. It lays out a practical approach to embed collaboration so that it takes root and thrives long-term. This sets the stage for the final chapter in this part. Chapter 9, Collaborating with Outside Partners. Truly smarter collaboration involves recognizing the limits of your own organization and then finding external partners with complementary expertise. We show how to cultivate a collaborative ecosystem well beyond your own borders. The other side of how is how not to. Troubleshooting collaboration challenges is the fourth of our four parts. Chapter 10, Watch Out, The Illusion of Inclusion, is purposely provocative. We argue that mismanaged collaboration, especially when it is used to provide a veneer of diversity, can actually marginalize certain workers. Without strategic oversight and measurement, collaboration can create the appearance of diversity without real inclusion. Mismanaged collaboration creates pitfalls beyond inclusion. In times of crisis, the strain on individuals and teams can destroy trust and weaken collaboration. Chapter 11, Watch Out, Pressure Undermines Collaboration, shows how to sustain a collaborative culture during crises, which can help separate your organization from the pack and set you up for a strong post-crisis rebound. Chapter 12, Watch Out, The Overcommitted Organization, explores the roots and perils of asking people to take on too much in the name of collaboration. For example, some companies throw teams non-strategically at every problem on the assumption that if some collaboration is good, more must be better. But spreading resources too thin and overusing teams for routine work leads to bottlenecks and burnout. We describe steps that can be taken on three levels, senior leader, teams, and individuals, both to head off overcommitment and to manage it when it arises. Our concluding chapter, Chapter 13, The Next Frontiers of Smarter Collaboration, foreshadows the exciting future of smarter collaboration, presenting overarching principles that we derive from the preceding chapters. This leads us to one last introductory thought. Smarter collaboration should be at the top of every senior leader's agenda because it is essential for addressing the highest value challenges and opportunities in today's complex, data-rich, war for talent setting. At the end of the day, collaborative success hinges on leadership focus and strategic execution. We hope that smarter collaboration helps you get there. Part 1. The Case for Smarter Collaboration. 1. The Business Case for Smarter Collaboration. Picture a huge multinational consumer electronics company headquartered in Europe. We'll call it Premier Tech. By all accounts, Premier Tech in the early 21st century was a highly siloed operation, characterized by a command and control management style. When Jen Baker arrived as the new chief technology officer for the audio and video division, she often found herself stymied by divisional and functional barriers. The company had products in more than a dozen separate divisions: audio and video, health, home products, personal care, and so on, each of which was run as a separate P&L. Each had its own empire to support it: production, software development, sales, distribution, and so forth. This siloed structure meant that Premier Tech was very fragmented, without much benefit from shared design thinking or interoperability, and with limited scale and innovation. Initially, Baker pulled together an informal team of about 24 disparate individuals, including software engineers, product designers, manufacturing experts, and people from the procurement, finance, and legal teams. We had conversations about innovations we were starting to see at trade shows and in the market, and the team members would build off each other, says Baker. These were people who had worked at Premier Tech for 20 years, and for the most part, still didn't know each other. But they knew our products, and they understood the market. We realized that we were making many, many, many suboptimal decisions because those decisions were all being made in isolation. Baker and her team of renegades hit on the idea of a home automation hub, drawing on their disparate perspectives to figure out what capabilities various residential customers would be interested in. Someone would pose a question: what can our system do to help elderly people in their homes? And representatives from multiple functions would work together to answer the question. The home automation hub that eventually emerged from this process wound up being packaged into many of Premier Tech's home, health, and personal care products, drawing together formerly disparate groups to an unprecedented degree. It was such a novel way of working for us, Baker told us. We tapped into all the brains that were needed, and it produced really strong financial results. Plus, people were thrilled to be working on this. For the first time in ages, our innovations were market-leading, and it made everyone from engineers to marketeers proud to be part of Premier Tech. This was a success in and of itself. But even more important, it persuaded the company's leaders to rethink how they organized and operated, because they realized how much more innovative and successful they could be when they broke down silos and transformed work. Premier Tech got lucky. They were lucky that Baker was a determined changemaker. They were lucky that she was able to build a network of colleagues across multiple functions and geographies, and that those colleagues shared her interest in coming up with creative solutions to the company's challenges. As a result, Premier Tech had the opportunity to move from counting on luck to relying on a new way of working, effective, cross-functional collaboration, which we refer to as smart collaboration. Smart collaboration involves highly specialized experts working together across traditional business silos to define and solve more complex problems and pursue more lucrative opportunities than any single group could do on its own. This chapter makes the case that smart collaboration is a significant driver of 5 major outcomes at the organizational level: revenues and profits, and the equivalent mission-driven outcomes for nonprofit organizations; faster innovation and better adoption; customer loyalty and retention; higher efficiency; and transparency and risk reduction. Most companies think they're already doing a lot of collaboration. This raises the question: if collaboration is already common, why do we need to win over more people and organizations? Well, first, not everyone has been persuaded. Most organizations still have holdouts who believe that operating independently gives them the greatest degree of power and therefore increases their chances of getting ahead. And second, even in organizations that have embraced collaboration generally, there is often a significant gap between what the corporate strategy proclaims — collaboration is one of our 4 strategic pillars — and the extent to which employees actually collaborate. It's not really part of my day job. It's more like the thing we get around to when our real work is done. So we still need to make a compelling business case for why leaders should embrace and promote collaboration. Let's review each of the foregoing arguments in favor of smart collaboration in turn, starting with money. How does collaboration help the bottom line? Smart collaboration boosts revenues and profits and performance outcomes for nonprofits. Simply stated, collaboration across functions, business units, and geographies leads to better financial outcomes for companies. Let's consider revenues first, followed by profits. Then we'll discuss similarly consequential performance outcomes for organizations that are not driven by profits. Revenues. Let's take a commercial real estate company as our first example. When they provide a single service to a client, say leasing to a retail chain, that service might generate X dollars, a straightforward fee for service. But what if they can make that service part of a larger property management lifecycle solution, focused on how to optimize a client's real estate portfolio over time? What if they can offer a solution that necessarily includes planning, finance, leasing, acquisition, disposal, consulting, property management, and more? If that happens, the leasing activity becomes more valuable because it is integrated with other disciplines to create a differentiated, value-adding strategy. Stated differently, leasing alone can be viewed as a commoditized offering, but in combination with other disciplines, it becomes strategic. And we don't mean to pick on commercial real estate leasing here. The same considerations and calculations hold true across a broad range of disciplines. Those disciplines are more valuable when they are integrated, and less valuable when they are freestanding. Capturing that exponential value requires experts from each of those separate disciplines, planning, finance, property management, etc., to come together in a way that we call smart collaboration. Figure 1-1, which can be found in the accompanying bonus PDF, depicts this. It shows rising revenue per customer, even as 5, 6, and 7 business lines become involved. Note that as more units collaborate on a client project or product offering, the average annual revenue from that offering, the bars, increases almost exponentially over and above what each unit would have earned from providing service in a discrete, siloed way, the flatter hypothetical trend line at the bottom of the graph. In fact, in this company, we saw that revenues were 7.1 times higher for accounts served by 3 business lines than by a single one. Those customers served by 5 business lines generated fees 20.4 times higher than those with just one kind of service. Our work reveals this pattern time and time again across a wide array of organizations, ranging from technology companies and financial institutions to traditional professional service firms like law and accounting. The underlying principles apply to both companies that are international and those that are entirely domestic and that range from very small to giant. Why? Where does the upside come from? It's not about a simple cross-sell, as in, do you want fries with that? Having a broader range of people, executives, product managers, client service experts, technologists, and finance managers, involved with a client in a coordinated way gives you more information about that client's needs, priorities, and preferences. If your account teams communicate effectively among themselves, and that's a big if that can't be left to chance, you can leverage these insights to spot opportunities to support the client and generate revenue that your less engaged competitors might overlook. Of course, some of the new work may be discrete projects or products. In the case of our commercial real estate company, for example, a contract to handle building maintenance for all of a client's properties in one city. But the big value-add opportunity arises when those individual units bring together their intel, that is, what they picked up in the course of the simple project, and think together about the customer's more complex challenges. That's how they start to identify the big questions and answer them in innovative, sophisticated ways. When you address the bigger, more complex challenges of the sort faced by chief-level officers, you gain access to more senior executives who have broader responsibilities, larger budgets, and more sophisticated needs. And of course, the more excellent work that you do for very senior executives, the greater your reputation and perceived legitimacy inside the client organization. That said, you don't need to be working at the board level for smart collaboration to have a major impact on revenue. One global retail bank we worked with provides a clear demonstration of this phenomenon. Our research uncovered patterns of collaboration that distinguished the highest performing branches, where different kinds of bankers played discrete roles in collectively generating higher quality integrated offerings for customers. In these branches, the frontline bankers used a combination of data, personal interfaces, and targeted outreach to identify customers' needs and generate interest in the bank's products. Product specialists then leveraged their expertise to create customized offerings that generated higher value for the customer. After controlling for a host of related variables, including the relative affluence of the neighborhoods and the number of nearby competitors, our analyses showed not only that more collaborative branches ultimately generated significantly higher revenue with those specific products, but also that the deeper and broader relationships translated into greater customer loyalty. Figure 1-2 illustrates the difference between more and less collaborative branches. Not surprisingly, these kinds of outcomes require significantly higher effort and genuine collaboration at the branch level, which presupposes both focus and motivation. Guidelines from headquarters direct the branch manager's attention toward creating an environment in which employees work together to achieve collective goals, an example of the end-to-end goals we discuss in Chapter 6. The product specialists, who serve multiple branches, play a critical role in spreading institutional wisdom and motivating the front line to make these additional efforts. "The jelly donuts make a difference," one executive observed. A mortgage specialist who brings treats to a branch builds stronger relationships with the frontline bankers. It's the power of the team that ultimately makes the difference. Our analyses show that most companies leave enormous amounts of money on the table when their business units don't collaborate. Figure 1-3 is pretty typical across the organizations we've studied. As we heard earlier, revenues increase dramatically with each additional business unit that joins the mix. The descending lines show that this company serves most clients with just one offering and has fewer and fewer clients as the service offerings broaden, the long tail problem. In Chapter 3, we dive into ways to run through experiments with your data to quantify just how much potential upside is there for you to capture. Everywhere that we've conducted this exercise, the resulting number has been eye-popping. For multinational corporations, is cross-border collaboration more lucrative? Generally, yes, because cross-border work is often especially complex and demanding, whether it's a software company supporting the complex regulatory requirements in myriad countries, a logistics company providing global support to a multinational manufacturer, or an investment bank supporting a multi-country merger and acquisition deal. Realistically, each new region may not provide an exponential revenue bump. As a bank expands internationally with its customers, it may grow from serving only the customer's London headquarters to serving their far-flung operations around the globe. Winning the Malaysian business will be a smaller victory than securing the UK business, obviously. But by growing with the customer, the bank becomes a more deeply embedded strategic partner. These kinds of gains tend to be enduring as well, especially because collaboration generates higher customer retention and customer satisfaction, as we discuss later. Growth through strategic partnering. Relationship growth is a long-term endeavor. Not every new piece of business immediately drives big increases in revenues, given that the next opportunity may be with a small product or from a smaller region. What the data shows, however, is that as you expand your product or service offerings within a given client, the revenue grows exponentially. Why? Again, because you become a more strategic partner. Let's consider a simple example of DrinkCo, which sells its extensive product line into a global hotel operator. The first sale was to the customer's All Suites brand. As DrinkCo's reputation grew, it started selling into the hotel chain's premium brand, budget brand, and golf resort brand. Of course, the acquisition of each of these new brands brought in incremental and welcome revenue. But more important, DrinkCo's account leaders started quarterly business reviews with each brand's executive team in which they discussed strategy and operations, focusing on how the DrinkCo product lineup, distribution, and promotional offerings could better support the hotel's seasonality and other fluctuations. With this deeper understanding, DrinkCo deliberately evolved its product. It addressed the unique needs of each brand and meanwhile created solutions across the businesses, which allowed the hospitality group to tap into better data, generate insights, and deliver both cost savings and better guest experiences. That strategic value allowed DrinkCo to not only sell an expanded line of products, but also experiment with more innovative offerings that commanded premium prices. Profits. Let's move on to profits. The kinds of holistic solutions developed through collaboration create the ability to not only deliver more solutions to existing buyers at your customer, but also be more profitable. As you move up the food chain at your customer, work for the C-suite is likely to be the most critical and therefore most valuable and highest margin. Further, expanding your relationship with existing customers is less expensive, total cost of sales, including marketing costs, time, etc., than landing work with new customers. In other words, this is a win along two key dimensions: higher margin work with a lower cost of sale. One senior manager at a consulting firm described it in these terms. When a board needs advice, I guarantee they're not asking the procurement department's permission on whom to hire. Recently, some headlines hit about forced labor in a certain country, and my client's board commissioned a supply chain review that required collaboration across experts from human rights, operations, regulatory, data science, and lots more. We could never have sold this in at a lower level, and the margin was excellent. Generally, moving the client to the right, to reinvoke the results shown in Figure 1-3, broadens the scope of work toward more sophisticated, multi-line solutions. Again, this move takes you out of the commodity game and into the realm of differentiated products and services. Let's review a simple example from a tech and data provider we'll call ReachPro. The company's core product was data that tracked the effectiveness of marketing campaigns, which subscribers downloaded and analyzed. Most customers used a third party's data visualization software to help them detect patterns in the data. But integrating these two software packages was a cumbersome process. So when ReachPro began offering a data visualization tool optimized to analyze the data it provided, uptake was dramatic. The new ReachPro tool was easy to use, and it came prepackaged with reports and graphs directly linked to the marketing data, allowing the company to charge a slight premium over the generic products in the market. Because ReachPro was selling exclusively to existing data customers, moreover, the cost of sales was low. Most executives understand intuitively that expanding existing relationships is one of the most cost-effective ways to grow. If companies had a way of capturing the true cost of sales, and many don't actually track this number accurately, most would find that it requires less time, effort, marketing expense, and risk to convert an existing customer into one that uses the full breadth of services than it does to woo a brand new customer of equal size away from a competitor. The bottom line: collaboration helps companies grow their profits. Collaboration on the individual level. Our main focus in this chapter is on the corporate and organizational level, but we should also emphasize that engaging in smarter collaboration delivers real benefits to individuals too. Check out the results for two senior people inside one organization. They share so many demographic and professional similarities that we jokingly refer to them as twins. They hold the same level and role inside the same department of their firm. They're both men of the same age who joined the company at roughly the same time. Yet their collaborative patterns are very different, as you see in the figure. Every dot represents a peer of the twins. The twins are circled. And the lines connecting them show that those people have worked together on at least one project for a significant amount of time in the year we studied them. Notice that Twin 1 worked with 6 colleagues this year, 3 of whom were within his department. Twin 2 collaborated with more than 30 other people, nearly three-quarters of whom were outside his department. Here's the kicker. We measured a set of business outcomes for each twin, such as the revenue growth and profitability of clients they led, customer satisfaction, and team health. Twin 2's outcomes were more than four times better than twin 1's. Mission-critical outcomes beyond profit. What if your focus isn't revenue and profit, but other kinds of performance outcomes? Maybe you work for a government agency tasked with enhancing the nation's cybersecurity. Or perhaps your work in the medical field focuses you on patient outcomes. In these examples, and in many other corners of the not-for-profit world, smarter collaboration can drive better results. Let's discuss healthcare. Patients are what matter most, and in most healthcare scenarios, positive patient outcomes absolutely demand collaboration. When surgeons partner with patients, caregivers, nurses, caseworkers, and advocates to coordinate patient care activities and communicate the right information to the right people at the right time, all the players are better positioned to provide safe, appropriate, and effective care. In fact, this kind of collaboration across hospital functions and occupations can reduce hospital readmission rates, in one documented case, by nearly 20%. This was a clear win-win. Not only did patients enjoy better outcomes, who wants to go back to the hospital, but providers saved an average of $15,000 per patient, enabling them to serve more patients and serve them better. Successful collaboration in the healthcare field not only occurs in traditional settings, it sometimes extends all the way to your wrist. In an innovative collaboration between technology and healthcare providers, wearable remote monitoring devices allowed nurses, nutritionists, and healthcare specialists to offer their patients individualized support and education, all drawing on multiple clinical specialties. A pilot study conducted with over 500 patients, for example, used secure messaging to increase adherence to treatment and improve outcomes for chronic myeloid leukemia patients. As a result of this innovative digital collaboration, pilot participants were 22% more likely to stick to their treatment regime. Again, this is only a quick sampling in two corners of an enormous economic sector, but it serves to illustrate our larger point, which is that even in realms where the bottom line doesn't necessarily involve dollars, collaboration leads to better outcomes and may also save money. Smart collaboration accelerates innovation and adoption. Many of us were raised on tales of the lone scientist burning the midnight oil, working against long odds and universal skepticism, until he finally had a eureka moment and delivered a brilliant breakthrough to the world. A more recent version of the same story celebrates the single-minded entrepreneur beavering away in his garage, maybe in cahoots with a nerdy friend, and coming up with the personal computer. These tales inspire us, of course. That's what they're meant to do. But they are less and less reflective of today's reality. In nearly every domain, two trends work against the freestanding genius. The first is that by necessity, our individual expertise continues to narrow into ever deeper specializations. Meanwhile, the complexity of the problems that we're trying to solve continues to increase. The result is predictable. Research into patent applications over the last 20 years clearly shows that innovation happens increasingly among teams working together on a project. See Figure 1-4. The average number of inventors per patent has grown steadily, almost linearly, from 1976 through 2020. Meanwhile, the number of patents with as many as 7 contributing inventors continues to grow steadily. Increasingly, breakthrough ideas require collaboration among individuals with diverse ideas and expertise. If the day of the lone inventor ever truly existed, that time has passed. These trends apply to innovation within companies as well. It's not enough to come up with a big idea. That idea also has to get to market. After all, innovation is applied creativity. Organizations need to turn that idea into a product or service offering, often a task that itself requires cross-silo work, and then bring that product or service to market, which requires further collaboration across multiple functional areas. In this complex sequence, intra-company collaboration increases the speed of discovery, the application of that discovery to products, and the introduction of novel offerings to the market. In addition, innovation increasingly involves collaboration with third parties along every step of the process of making a discovery and applying it: creation, marketing, production, and distribution. In Chapter 9, we focused on the whys and hows of collaborating with third parties, up to and including partnerships with competitors. Through these kinds of partnerships, diverse organizations bring together their unique capabilities, intellectual property, services, and products to develop a differentiated and specialized solution to target customer needs. Done well, that combination creates more value than the sum of its parts, and it can capture market share faster than traditional product development approaches. And remember, collaboration is crucial for the kinds of innovation that may have far more impact than traditional business outcomes. For example, Terramira, an agricultural technology company based in Vancouver, Canada, has emphasized innovative collaboration at the heart of its operation. One of the company's key initiatives is to scale the practice of regenerative agriculture, which, says Terramira, results in wins for consumers, farmers, and the planet. The numbers are dramatic. Regenerative farming is estimated to be 78% more profitable. It's better for the environment. Every 1% increase in organic matter results in as much as 20,000 gallons of available soil water per acre. Finally, regenerative agriculture results in healthier crops, which yield, on average, 34% more vitamin K, 11% more calcium, and 15% more vitamin E. Despite the many benefits associated with regenerative farming, it is hard to persuade the world's farmers to go this route. It requires super collaboration across many stakeholders to solve this challenge, including scientists, governments, farmers, agronomists, investors, universities, and many more. To drive home the value, Terramira has brought together experts in computational chemistry, biology, machine learning, and advanced robotics to predict how molecules interact and behave in various states and climates. These insights allow Terramira to recommend how best to improve soil and plant health almost anywhere in the world. They are also essential to helping farmers quantify the value of the transition to regenerative agriculture. To test and commercialize this technology, Terramira is working with leading experts, including farmers, soil scientists, universities, and agronomists, to get real-time input and feedback with the aim of training data models that predict the optimal path in the regenerative transition. At the same time, in an effort to rapidly scale this work, Terramira is collaborating with investors and governments to expedite the creation of protocols for carbon credit generation, tools to support and scale regenerative agriculture, and methods to reach more farmers. Who benefits from all this collaboration-driven innovation? Farmers are enjoying higher farm profits, greater soil health and water retention, resulting in resilience to weather changes, and access to new income streams, including from carbon credits. Investors benefit from their stake in a growing business. Consumers benefit from cleaner, more nutrient-dense food, the cultivation of which leaves farmland in better shape with each passing growing season. Society and the planet benefit from a reduction in pesticide use and a drawdown of carbon from the atmosphere into soil, where it builds and enriches soil health, which in turn presents the opportunity to begin turning back the clock on climate change. Smart collaboration enhances customer loyalty and retention. Customer satisfaction is a natural outgrowth of the deeper engagement, faster innovation, and better solutions that smart collaboration helps to deliver. For example, Jane Ashton, former president of the U.S. division of a global telecoms company, recalls how her division's work to embed collaboration led to a significant uptick in the company's Net Promoter Score, or NPS, the most widely used metric to evaluate the loyalty that exists between a provider and a customer. "We were running global sales channels for technology, life sciences, and the remaining hodgepodge of customers we lumped into business services. Each division operated in a silo, with no sharing or learning happening across the groups. Our NPS scores hovered in the 30s. When I became president, we launched a culture change initiative to improve how we worked with each other and with our customers. We started having conversations that built on each other, seeking others' opinions, challenging, and even interrupting in the spirit of exploration, finding ways to improve our team and serve our customers better. I paired people up across divisions for peer coaching. We built a healthy spirit of challenge and collaboration to bring best practice to customers. And our NPS scores started climbing. After 2 years, they nearly reached.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.